morning. I don't think I've ever been at a show with such an amazing opening act. I feel like a rock star right now. I'm here to talk about augmented reality, the potential for it, how it's being used in the workforce today. It's really quite at the beginning stages, but it's already empowering and transforming workforces everywhere. But first, I wanted to talk a little bit about who we are. So DAQRI, not like the drink, but DAQRI. We're headquartered in LA. We've been around for a long time, actually. We started working on AR really back in 2010, first looking at augmented reality applications, kind of what you probably are seeing today with AR Kit and AR Core on the iPhone and Android devices, but we did that a long time ago. And then somewhere in 2013, we started really focusing the company on professional-grade augmented reality. How do we use AR to help workforces perform their tasks better? Is there a value for augmented reality there? So we're in LA, but we have a very international presence. We've got three offices in Europe, sales, engineering, a lot of computer vision work as well, which are some of the core technologies for AR. And you know, this technology is still in the nascent stages, so a lot of the work is actually still developed in-house at DAQRI. But let's start with what is augmented reality. And I'm willing to bet here, like as much as you guys might think AR is a new phenomenon, it's not. It's actually been around for a very long time. The textbook definition of AR is when you have a live view of the world and you can put digital content on it in real time. So the three elements are a live view, you can get it through a camera, through a lens, whatever, and then you're able to put digital content, what we call augmentations, and therefore augmented reality. If you've watched football games, that's an example of AR. Because the first down line, the yellow line on TV, that doesn't exist in the real world. That's digital content that's superimposed on top of the camera view that's coming to your TV broadcast. So that's an example of AR, right? Been around, very useful, we take it for granted. But even going back in popular culture, for some of us who are older, this is from Terminator, the very first one, actually, when Arnold Schwarzenegger comes back in time and he starts analyzing the world, and it's simple data, it's all two-dimensional text, useful to find somebody. More recently, Minority Report, right? You guys remember that movie? Use an interface, uses his hands, there's digital content that he's manipulating it. And then even more recently, there's Tony Stark here, trying to repair and build something really cool. And you'll see how the content in those generations of movies has changed from simple two-dimensional text to much richer data to nice 3D models, right? So that shows you the potential for AR. But then it became a mass phenomenon, really, with Pokemon Go. There was no way you were going to avoid this one, so I have to talk about it. And I see some people saying they love it here. But this is really how Pokemon Go came, sort of got augmented reality into the mainstream. Most people think of AR as a technology. It's a new technology, right? And you'll hear these terms, AR, VR, MR, XR. They're all different combinations of fundamentally the same thing, which is putting digital content in the real world in some fashion. But let's take a step back and look at different computing paradigms. So in the 60s and 70s, you had a mainframe. Didn't really have displays or anything like that, but it crunched a lot of data, right? And it did something with that data and was able to do predominantly calculations and records keeping. And then the PC and laptop, and I'll just lump those into the same category of devices, but they unleashed dramatic gains in productivity, dramatic changes in workflows. You think about workforces is very, very different once you had a PC or a laptop. Even the mobile worker, the idea of a mobile worker started becoming a reality once you had a laptop and then a tablet, but really took off when you went to mobile, which was another computing paradigm, right? So these are all different generations of computing paradigms that fundamentally disrupted workforces everywhere. Separate layers, different companies dominated each of these curves, right? And for us, the way we look at it is that augmented reality is a new computing paradigm. And why do I say new? You know, as human beings, we perceive the world in 3D. Everything is three-dimensional, right? We can control it. You know, there's this thing, this clicker is three dimensions, this room, the people. And for a long time, we took all this three-dimensional data, from sensors, from machines, from spreadsheets, and we visualized it in a two-dimensional screen. Yes, that was very useful. It was very digital. It was very good. You know, all the productivity gains we've seen have predominantly come from these transformational technologies. But for the first time, augmented reality allows us to put that two-dimensional data back in the world. Remember, it's digital content physically in context to the real world. So now the sensor data is not just available on a screen, but is actually on the machine where it is sensing from, right? And that allows new kinds of gains to be unlocked because now workers don't need to carry a different kind of device, can get different kinds of insights and make decisions there. So we are at the beginnings of a new compute paradigm and therefore a generational shift in long-term digital, long-term sort of proliferation of digital data back into the physical world in context where people actually use it. So it's quite a big shift. Now, I always get asked this question, what's going on? There's a lot of automation, there's AI, how does it actually fit with AR, right? And so I have to address it. Automation will always exist. It has existed since the wheel was invented, right? So there's different degrees of it, and so there's always going to be that natural sort of, there's that inclination for us to make things easier, to make things faster. So that's always existed. And AI has, in a form, existed in much weaker, in a weaker sense. Of course, there's huge shifts today coming with AI, and we talk about AI as, you know, taking jobs away or automating tasks. I don't look at it like that. It's, yes, it's going to do some of that, but no, it's not going to replace the human. Because things like technologies like augmented reality actually augment the human. You know, we're not, I don't believe in a dystopian world where, you know, machines rule everything, although we do have factories where we don't have workers today. That is true. We are getting to a place where you have automated factories, but you always have humans making decisions, even from insights. And it's part of something. As human beings, we're a little bit irrational, right? It's hard for a computer system to actually model that irrationality inside a rational system of logic where, and you need that to make certain decisions. So I don't actually believe that. And technologies like augmented reality, in a sense, augment a human and make them, you know, some people say superhuman, but we'll just say, make them more prepared for a world where there's much more digital data, many more insights, many more automation technologies. So what is DAQRI focused on, right? So where the technology is today in AR, really believe that all work is human. You know, you need human beings to perform these works. There are a lot of assets. There's physical assets, machinery. Those things are not going to go away. Vehicles, tools, facilities. You need them. Somebody has to do them. There's also digital assets, right? Companies have invested tremendous amount of money in ERP systems and automation systems and robotics, and all of these have to come together because at the end of the day, you need these systems to work together. You need to be compliant to regulations. You need to be compliant to quality standards. And that's where AR really begins to help workforces be more effective. So we're really, really focused on helping workforces be effective with professional grade AR. Now, notice that I don't talk about worker. Not once have I said worker. I've said workforces everywhere. And that's the critical thing. Because what these devices do really is they empower workers with data and insights to make decisions in the field rather than record and then go back to an office somewhere, discuss with your peers, discuss with your supervisor, and then figure out what the right decision is. Work with the AI systems, direct them, in a sense, use AI. You connect the workers up, get insights back to the supervisor and the manager so they can help their workers, and that's how you make a much more productive workforce. This is not about the worker. This is about the workforce. And it's a nuance, but it's a very critical distinction for us because that's how we approach all our use cases. That's how we approach pretty much everything that we do at DAQRI with our customers as well. So where is augmented reality adding value today? For us, it's really where complex tasks meet high-value assets, right? So if you Google AR, you know, you'll find all kinds of quirky examples of that. I showed you a few, but you'll see people trying to do these complex assemblies on very simple assets at times. But where it actually has value is these high-value assets, so buildings, manufacturing plants, production lines, machinery, turbines, vehicles, forklifts, yeah, cranes, high-value assets, right? We're not talking about a $100 piece of tool. We're talking about thousands of dollars. Those are the kinds of things where AR actually has a lot of value, simply because you actually perform very, very complex tasks on these things. You got to design those products. That's the first thing. Then you got to build them. You got to operate them. So lots of times the workflows are very, very bespoke. You do it once. You don't repair this thing every day. You probably maintain it on a periodic basis, once in 6 months, once a year. So you, every time you do it, the maintenance procedure is a little bit different. So these are repetitive tasks, but they're complex in nature, right? They draw on years of experience, skills from a variety of systems, insights from a variety of sensors, and you see how, at the end of the day, it's the human being that has to do the task. It is very chronic in nature, right? And that's where AR adds a lot of value. So where are customers using this today, right? So there's a whole, and I'll talk a little bit more about this, but you know, this is just a snapshot of our current customers. We have over 100 customers today actively using our technologies in production workflows, and there are many more using it in a research and pilot capacity, right? So companies are already beginning to see the value in this and are in the early stages of pretty big transformation initiatives inside their workforces in plants around the world. Predominantly, I will say this is a European phenomenon. A lot of our customers are actually in Europe. North America is actually somewhat behind on this thing, but it is rapidly catching up. And I don't know the exact reason for that, honestly, except that I've been in the space for about 10 years, and I've been seeing a long interest in sort of Europeans company interest in using technology to improve productivity, and AR was a natural offshoot of that. So they've been looking at this for a long time, and only now the hardware and the software has actually come to a point where they can actually use it. Okay, so you know, we talked about training, field service, and facilities management. These are sort of the three segments where you actually see AR taking off today. So you can be assured that all workforces in these areas are being transformed today. This is not a phenomenon that's coming tomorrow or day after. This is happening now around the world too. So I wanted to talk about one training use case, and UIMM, and I'd never heard of them, but they're a training consortium in France. They represent about 42,000 businesses in France, and they have about 60 centers all over France. Their job is really retraining workers for very specific tasks, right? So they represent everyone from the small tool shop down the road to Safran, GE, Airbus, all the big Siemens, all the big ones. And these big companies will have, let's say, a new piece of equipment, and they want to train workers in that. So they'll provide money to UIMM to help create new training courses, right? So UIMM has just deployed an entire center in Laval where they're using this right now. They've been using it for about a month now. Where they're training workers, and the response has been phenomenal. Because, you know, there's the traditional classroom techniques of, like, paper is two-dimensional, right? And you have to visualize all these very complex tasks in 3D. And that's one thing where workers really have found that it's the learning outcomes, it's how fast you do something, and how much you retain post that procedure is much higher when you use AR. And these are all very well documented, not just with our technology, our products, but also other studies in the market. So let me talk about a few more use cases. So you know, this is a project we did with Siemens, their gas turbine division. So that's a turbine. That's how big it is. And there's a component there that you have to change within that, the gas burner. So typically, you're a mechanical engineer, right? So now, if you think about all the kinds of use cases I talked about earlier, they felt somewhat less engineering heavy or more vocational training type. This is a mechanical engineer from a 4-year degree college, and then they get a lot of classroom training, And then they come into this massive facility where there are three people who help them learn how to train for the whole day. And that's repeated over a week, right? So it's a lot of training time. And what we were able to do with AR is really reduce that training time to less than an hour. All the person, there's nobody involved. The gas burner was there in the facility. The new recruit would come in. He's finished his classroom training. You can't get around that part. But that last step of the training, you wear these glasses, you walk up to the burner, and then it gives you step-by-step instructions on the burner, and you learn how to train it. And there's massive other advantages to this when you actually deploy it, because you can train the person in the field without taking the turbine down, right? So if you think about the what does this do for us, it reduces downtime, which is another massive increase in productivity for workforces everywhere. Another example with Siemens, this is actually now part of Siemens Gamesa after their merger. So here what happens is you have a worker that actually climbs all the way to the top of the turbine into the nacelle, which is that big room-sized thing behind the turbines, behind the rotors. And once they climb in, what they would do traditionally is they'd go with a clipboard and paper and maybe a tablet, and they'd go around inspecting different points for failures and maintenance, routine things. What they found is that people actually missed a lot of this. And this is important for compliance and just sort of, you know, preventing future problems with the turbine. So with AR, they were not only able to do it faster, but they were much more accurate, and they didn't miss any spots. Because the AR, when you wear the glasses, the technology guides you through every spot that you have to see. And that is a game changer, right? The city of LA, this is a very recent one. You know, 60% of their workforce is going to retire in the next couple of years. And so they have a big problem where they have to actually transfer knowledge to a new workforce. So this is an actual example that they've deployed right now, where these headphones are for emergency service workers. There is one person that can service and fix and repair those headsets today. One person, right? So forget the knowledge transfer part. It's a single point of failure. So they used an AR app to train interns to repair this. And here's what the results look like. Traditional techniques are like hours, and then people just go away. And then with this application and the glasses, interns were able to repair this in, you know, they took on an average 5 minutes out there, but let's say they practiced a few times. Even if they practiced 10 times, that's still better than the outcome. And then you always have the knowledge transfer piece, right? So more broadly, the way I look at these things is, these are all about elevating skills. You think about AI as sort of automation of certain things. AR lets you elevate your skills, right? It makes you a Superman in some cases. You can be servicing a jet engine today and an automobile engine tomorrow. That is the promise of AR, right? And we're not far away from that. We're getting there. Yeah, we're pretty close to all these things. What does it take to go to the next level? So if this is so good, you know, the natural question is, why aren't more people deploying it? You know, yes, people are beginning to look at it, and certainly we've seen some very early successes with it. But the biggest barrier right now with AR is really creating that content. How do you create those work instructions? How do you create, this doesn't exist, right? But the answer is much more nuanced. It actually does exist in different systems. It exists in your ERP systems, it exists in your PLM systems, it exists in your HR training systems as well. The challenge really is taking all that two-dimensional data, automating it in a sense, like where you can automatically bring it into whatever application you're building, because you do not want companies to buy these devices and then spend a lot of money building these applications to train workers. That is a barrier. So we recognized that, I don't know, probably 8 months ago when, you know, we had the hardware and we would give them all the tools and SDKs to build applications, but it was taking months and months and months for people to actually build that end product that their workers could use. And so for us, it became like, okay, how can we speed this up? So we ended up sort of surveying the landscape of our customers, and we were very lucky at that time. You know, we'd done a lot of these case studies with Siemens and Rolls-Royce and all these partners. And what we found is that no matter how big you are, or no matter the vertical that you play in, there are really five tasks that you perform in AR. These are very common tasks. I have a problem, I don't know how to fix it, I need to show somebody how to do that. So someone calls in remotely, looks at what I'm looking, annotates it, and I learn that way. So it's fixing the problem, reducing downtime, and annotations, and sort of knowledge transfer right then. I need to scan my surroundings and capture it in 3D. I don't need not just a picture or a video, but I actually have to create a 3D model of the as-is state of a piece of equipment when it breaks down, right? Or when I fix it, I want to capture it for audit and compliance. So that was another common task. I want to put virtual post-it notes in this room so that I can point out pain points or problematic areas for the for other people to come into the room, see the virtual post-it notes, and then go fix it. Because oftentimes, people who need to fix problems are searching for the piece of equipment or the place or the junction box or whatever it is that they need to fix. They spend a lot of time on that. You'd be surprised even today how much wastage there is in the system. I need to see a 3D model. This is like the most basic AR use case, right? Not a 3D model of robots, but a 3D model of this building so that I know where the pipes are, where the HVAC is, so that I can make the right decisions out there. And lastly, I need simple work instructions to guide me through this process, right? So what we did is we really built this productivity suite called DAQRI WorkSense that incorporates those five tasks as five out-of-the-box applications. So think of this as like, you know, you buy a computer, and then you buy what, Microsoft Word or Office 365? Some productivity suite, right? You install a browser, you do, and without those two, you can't really do anything with your computer. It's like back in the old days of DR-DOS or MS-DOS, right? So you need that productivity suite for AR to really take off. And so we built DAQRI WorkSense, and WorkSense really is a platform that connects to assets that you already have deployed, whether that's an SAP system, an IBM Maximo system, so you can leverage the assets you have, the leverage the work instructions you have, and basically reduce all the barriers to entry to deploy something at scale. That's been really, really well received, and that's why we've seen an uptick in sort of deployments. Again, it's predominantly Europe where we see all these things happen. So it's all really, really simple applications and tasks, but can dramatically change productivity and workers, and really enhance what workers can do, right? Rather than going out for services. So you'll see, like our team, you know, on the one hand, you have this AI thing that sort of seems to be automating a lot of tasks and sort of taking away from people. On the other end, you know, you see more and more, you do need humans for these things. You do need human decision makers to really understand those insights, and that's where AR really helps. You know, I'll leave you with this. I was at Hanover Messe in April, and it's the largest industrial trade fair in the world, and you know, in Germany, obviously. And the theme there last year was all about the Internet of Things, right? You probably have heard this Industry 4.0, and the theme was take data from machines, put sensors on machines, take all that data, and see what you can do with it. That was last year. This year, they use the term digitalization of the worker. I heard it incorrectly. It wasn't digitizing the worker, it was digitalization of the worker, right? And it was all about augmenting workers with tools and technologies that prepare them for this kind of a reality. That is today, it's not tomorrow, it is today. And augmented reality in DAQRI is at the forefront of making this a reality in enterprises. So with that, I'm almost out of time, so thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any questions later. Thank you.